It's time for Howlers and Growlers. A weekly show from our Arizona Coyotes writing pack, bringing you the latest news, rumors, trades, player grades, prospects, and much more. From training camp to the playoffs, from draft day to the trade deadline, our team covers everything ice hockey in the hot desert. So sit back, grab your favorite cold beverage, and get ready for Howlers and Growlers.
Welcome to Howlers and Growlers. I'm your host, Pat Brown, and we are thrilled to have you join our show for another week. Great to be back. Joining me as always, my Coyotes line mate, Haynes Evans. Haynes, thanks for welcoming me back. How you doing?
I'm doing great. I'm happy to be able to take my seat in the second spot next to you. I'm happy for you to take the roles back, but I've had a good week. I'm happy to have you back. I'm ready to talk some hockey.
Well, you did a fantastic job holding down the fort last week and certainly appreciate you doing that. And obviously your friends from Chirpin are welcome anytime awesome. On the show. So speaking of friends, we've got a great friend of the show joining us today as well. A repeat guest, if you will, from the blog Five for Howling, Carl Pavlock. Carl, thanks for joining us again. How you doing?
I'm doing great. Happy to be back. Coyotes haven't been the most fun team to watch, but actually kind of fun to talk about. So glad to be back.
Yeah, there's certainly no shortage of topics, even if there is a shortage of wins. So
yeah, exactly. Exactly.
I just came up with that right now. I'm kind of proud of that.
It's a good one. I may steal that.
Let's take care of business. You guys know the drill and the spirit of the show. I am actually drinking Four Peaks Hopknot IPA, a classic here around the valley. Gotta love it. Gotta love it. Carl, what you got today?
I have another Bonehouse. It's Englishman's Elixir Prickly Pear Pale Ale. Ooh. I always like the prickly pear beers.
No, I was going to say, is there anything that prickly pear doesn't do well? Because it makes fantastic tea as well, for what it's worth. So
I've never had tea because I'm not a big tea drinker, but that's a good flavor for it. I can imagine that being tasty.
It's good stuff for sure. Haynes, bring us home. What do you got this week?
I'm going relatively real basic this week. I'm not no fancy sours, no nothing like that. I'm drinking an Angry Orchard. I'm just
nice.
Cider this week.
You know the old trick, right? Drop a shot of Fireball in that. And if you've never done that before, you should, because it's delicious. Absolutely delicious.
It's like a cinnamon apple. I'll have to do that.
The actual term for this, for that drink, is an Angry Balls. True story.
Awesome.
So, it's a good name. Really good name.
Local watering hole here does that very, very well. So highly recommend. 5 stars. Highly recommend. All right. Well, let's get out of the introduction and actually start talking some hockey, because we've got quite a bit of ground to cover today. And first and foremost, well, the Coyotes are winless and injured in the Valley, so we've got quite a bit to talk about. First, let's talk about the wins or lack thereof. As we sit right now at the time of taping, which is, spoiler alert, Wednesday evening, Coyotes are 0-5-1. What's going on? Is this a surprise? Why can't the Coyotes manage a win? And to be honest, with the exception of the overtime, the shootout loss early on in the season, they haven't been close a whole lot either. So Carl, as our guest, I'll kick it over to you first. What's going on with the Coyotes? Why can't they win a game?
Well, I think this is expected. This team is not good. I think we all went into the season knowing that they're not good. A big issue I'm seeing right now is a lack of chemistry. Like, they don't seem to be used to playing with each other. I think last time I was on, that's something that I may have talked about, because I talk about it a lot because it's very apparent. Mm-hmm. Something I really noticed in the Florida game, though, is just a really poor play in the neutral zone, having difficulties there. That definitely needs to be cleaned up in the next couple games.
They do seem to be struggling with the opposition's forecheck quite a bit. And I don't know, maybe we got our hopes up because, you know, they did perform awfully well in the preseason. But I often remind people that my chosen football team, the Detroit Lions, oh, that hurts to say out loud. They had a perfect preseason the year they went 0-16. So just remember that. Haynes, over to you. Why can't the Coyotes win a game? What's going on?
You know, we actually kind of hit this on the pod, and, you know, I kind of hit at it last week, and I think the biggest thing for them that I've noticed is kind of a lack of confidence. I feel like a lot of games you've seen, this team's coming real, not cocky, but real confident that they can play a strong game, and then they go down within a goal, two goals after leading, like the St. Louis game, and they just they seem to lose all confidence. All the players just seem to give up trying, and those games get out of hand real quick. And that was the game with St. Louis. I mean, two quick goals. You went from 2-1 to 3-2, and that team just seemed to all of a sudden fold in on itself. And I think that's their biggest issue right now, is they're starting to fall behind games instead of trying to fight back in, minus the Florida game, which was a good comeback from behind effort.
Yeah.
They fold into themselves. They seem to regress and fold in.
Yeah, to your point about the Blues game, by the way, you said two quick goals. It was like five quick goals. Yeah,
I don't think I've ever seen.
And I wasn't here. I wasn't in the Valley. I was on a business trip and following on my phone, and I couldn't believe when my phone kept buzzing and I kept getting these updates that it was five goals in 5 minutes or so. Yeah. I don't know if I've ever seen that. That was wild. But you guys hit the nail on the head, right? There's clearly an issue with team chemistry. Not necessarily anybody's fault, but they're just not firing on all cylinders. It may be part of it, maybe learning Andre Turini's new system as well, which, let me tell you, when they run that system well, it works. They lost to the Islanders, Saturday? And let me tell you, they outplayed the Islanders. They probably deserved a win, and instead they lost 3-0. Just absolutely brutal when you figure they outshot them, they outchanced them, they look good, and nothing to show for it. So they've had some hard luck as well, but I think you guys made all the right points. I think team chemistry is big. They have some trouble when the opposition's forechecking, trying to get out of the zone. They really have to work on those exit zone passes and things like that. But good perspective. We're going to move on to injuries because, well, they had dodged the injury bug until yesterday. Basically. And now we get word that obviously the Coyotes have lost three players to injury in the same game, in the Florida game, none more significant than goalie Carter Hutton. But obviously defenseman Connor Timmins, who's expected to miss 8 to 12 weeks, brutal. And forward Ryan Zingles also out with an upper body injury, no timetable on his return. Hutton's expected to be out 2 to 4 weeks or so per Craig Morgan. So
Real quick, Nick Schmaltz also day to day injured.
When
just
did that
came
happen?
Out today.
Oh,
this afternoon I was like checking Twitter and it's like Schmaltz is day to day. It's like, oh,
man, I was going to say shameless plug here, but I do the Coyotes daily download every morning and I checked the injury report and that wasn't even on there this morning. So
this afternoon, like hours before this.
Wow. So Nick Schmaltz is out as well. We'll see what moves they make there. But what I want to talk about right now is the goalie situation, because I was already a pretty fragile state before Carter Hutton went down. Now, not that Hutton's played particularly well, but he has the NHL experience. I wrote an article. You guys should check it out. Really quick plug. Currently, between having Ivan Prosvetov and Karel Vejmelka up, the Coyotes have a grand total of 378 minutes of NHL experience.
Wow.
Four total starts, and three of those came this year with Vejmelka. So not a whole lot of experience between the two of them. What do you make of this tandem that we're going to see face off first at Tampa Bay coming up? Carl, we'll start with you.
Well, I think the Hutton being only injured short term is important here, because I don't think the team wants Prosvetov to be the backup goaltender in the NHL this year. I think they want him in the AHL being a full time starter. Vejmelka, I think, has looked pretty okay. I'll be curious to see what he, you know, how he looks. If things go bad, if Hutton is injured long term, I think they probably look to acquire someone, because I don't think the team is at the point where they want to have the goalie tanking the season. They have the players in front of the goalie to do that. They don't need to make it horrible.
Yeah, and it provides a good opportunity, right? So Ivan can come up and get some time at the NHL level. Obviously, that'll give Josef Korinar in Tucson an opportunity to really kind of backstop them as Prosvetov is up at the NHL level. So it'll be interesting to see. Haynes, your thoughts on the current goalie tandem that we're going to see for probably at least a couple weeks here?
Yeah, you know, I was actually kind of surprised that Ivan Prosvetov actually received the call up over Josef Korinar just because Korinar has a little bit more experience.
A little bit,
not much. A couple more.
I think seven games with the Sharks.
San Jose, and I think
six more.
Two of them were actually the last two games against the season against the Coyotes, actually. I think we're two of his last of the year. So I don't know. I mean, is it really much of a difference if Korinar comes over Prosvetov? Not really in the long run. You're going to maybe add a couple more minutes, honestly, maybe like 100 more at best, a little bit more than that, honestly. But, I mean, I agree with what Carl said. I think if Hutton's out longer than they expected, I would expect this team to want to go in a different direction and in terms of either signing someone or acquiring someone, just because I already feel bad for Karel Vejmelka now, because he's now never played over in North America and he's being tasked to be the starting goalie now for a team. And at 25, especially with Prosvetov not being much younger than him, when you're young like that on a team losing, the first thing you got to worry about is a goalie's confidence being destroyed. Constantly losing hurts a goalie's confidence and helping him grow in a game. So that's like the biggest issue for me is just watching is how do the Coyotes respond with two really young guys in net and, you know, kind of help those guys out to, you know, not feel like they're just terrible goaltenders and they can't play in this league.
And, oh, by the way, who do the Coyotes have coming up on the schedule? It's not like they've got the Blackhawks and the Red Wings and whoever else coming up. No, the Coyotes have the Tampa Bay Lightning, the Washington Capitals, and the Carolina Hurricanes, and even to a lesser degree, in my opinion, but still, the Philadelphia Flyers. Mm-hmm. And then the Ducks, but we won't worry about them as much. I mean, welcome to the NHL, boys. Just have fun. Don't take any penalties against Washington. Just don't take any at all. Just don't take any. Don't give number eight.
Let Ovi have any shot in the slot. Hand play Ovi in the slot the entire time.
Have you ever seen that meme with Ovi wide open and it just says how not to defend Ovechkin on the penalty?
And everybody's on the other side of the ice.
So, well, that's a pretty good segue because speaking of the penalty kill, holy hell, guys, 35% is the Coyotes penalty kill right now. They're the worst in the league by 20 percentage points. And they've given up 9 goals on 14 tries. And if there's any silver lining here, it's that the 14 penalties they have taken is second lowest in the league. So thank God for that, or it'd be even worse. But that penalty kill. Brutal. And what are you going to make of it? So Carl, what do you do to address this penalty kill that has been mightily struggling early on?
It's really tough. I'm going to go back to something Haynes said earlier. The team has no confidence right now when things get hard and penalties are when things get hard. And like, they just do not seem to play well on the penalty kill. I don't know what it's going to take to turn that around. They just need to get out of their own heads or something because it's only getting worse as they let in more goals on that.
Absolutely. And you know what's been really frustrating? The past two or three games, they've taken penalties late in periods. They did it against the Islanders. They were only down 1-0. Looked like they were heading into the intermission, still down 1-0. And the last 10 seconds, give up a goal. And that's such a backbreaking goal going into the breakdown too. And then it happened again. They were going to go into the break against the Panthers, the unbeaten Panthers. They were going to go into the break 1-0. Clayton Keller scored on that breakaway. And then Clayton Keller took a penalty and the Panthers scored. 92-year-old Joe Thornton scored.
Oh my God, that beard. It's
I know.
I feel emasculated looking at that beard. It's just,
it rivals anything Moses could put together, to be honest.
It's like almost bigger than my face at this point.
Absolutely.
He's like auditioning for ZZ Top.
I love it. And so that's the thing, right? Like, And that was Thornton's first goal of the year, by the way. And he was a healthy scratch earlier in the year. And why not? What better time to come in, I guess, than against the Coyotes? But those late period penalties have been killing Arizona. Haynes, your take on the penalty kill, and is there anything that can be done to address it?
It's not good. It's not good. I mean, it's bad. I mean, like you said, perfect example was Blair's calls was with New York and all that, mm-hmm. and giving up that late goal. Florida was another excuse right there. I mean, mm-hmm. you got 1-0 early start. Keller, great goal, beautiful move on Spencer Knight, and then mm-hmm. penalty seconds later, and they score on it. I mean, and that just reiterates my point back to the whole. The Coyotes get into a groove. They get going. They feel like they're moving the puck well. They're out shooting some of these teams. They go on the penalty kill. They give up a goal. They go on the penalty kill again, land again, give another goal. Both those goals either end up giving them, putting them down, or increases their deficit, and they fold and they fall out of games. Yep. And if you can't fix that, you're going to be losing a lot of games really badly. One, there is a benefit of doubt. They're the lowest penalized team in the league right now, but we played 6 games this year. 14 points in 6 games isn't terrible, but if you add 14 more in the next 6 games, you're looking at 28 and and 12 games, and it starts to pile up. So
it does.
You got to think Tournier's looking at roster moves. He's got to be looking at lines. He's got to be thinking himself, who can I put on the ice that gives us the best chance of killing penalties successfully? No one says you have to bring it up and score a goal. Who gives me the best chance to get the puck, play physical, and clear it out of the zone and just kill that penalty?
Yep, absolutely. And, of course, to be fair, probably the law of averages the other day, because Clayton Keller did score on the Coyotes' first shot and their only shot in the first period.
Yeah,
100%,
100% shooting the first period.
It was just maybe that was the law of averages a little bit. And speaking of the law of averages, you have to think this penalty kill will stabilize slightly. If they're 35% PK for the rest of the year, they may go 0-81-1 if that's the case. So you've got to think things are going to average out a little bit, but work to be done. And you guys both hit the nail on the head. You got to develop that confidence. You've got to, walk tall, skate tall, and clear the puck. So good stuff. Let's take a quick timeout. Let's pay some bills. Toss us a like, hit subscribe, be sure to comment. Thank you again for watching. Make sure you check out all of our other shows on the Hockey Writers Network. We've got Saber Scoop, Hockey Writers Grindline, Chicks and Sticks, What's Cracking, Blackhawks Banter, Union Junction, and so much more. You guys know the drill. We're on Spotify. We're on iHeartRadio. Certainly, we're on Twitter at HowlersTHW. And while you're at it, toss Carl and Five for Howling a follow as well at 5 Howling. And thanks for being with us. We love that you're taking some time out watching what we have to say about the Coyotes, and let us hear it in the comments. We'll talk about you next week on the air. So, all right. Our bills are paid. We live to see another week. And let's talk about, Carl, I think it was you that threw it out earlier in the show, a trade. If there needs to be a long-term goalie solution, there may need to be a trade. Well, funny you should say that, because boy, the rumor mill has certainly been swirling around Mr. Phil Kessel. And I believe we actually ran something earlier today at the Hockey Writers indicating he might be a good fit for the Lightning with Kucherov out. So that makes a lot of sense, to be honest, yeah. But there are a lot of options out there, and you got to think before the deadline hits, he's going to be dealt. But you never know. So Carl, I want to start with you again. Curious, where do you think Phil Kessel ends up?
You know, it's funny you said that. Like, this is the first time I'm thinking of trading Phil Kessel for a goalie prospect.
Sure.
Which is just kind of, I'm like, what are those possibilities? Yeah. But I don't know. I'm hearing a lot of talk about the Golden Knights, like not insider talk, but just a lot of people saying that's a good fit. I do think that's a good fit. Watching the Florida Panthers play, I honestly think maybe they could be kind of in for it. Like, surprised at how well they're doing this season. They seem like they could go for like a good playoff push. Phil Kessel could be a good piece for that. I think those two are the ones that, in my mind, make the most sense. I think for Bill Armstrong, he's mostly just looking for, a second round pick.
Yeah.
Because yeah. That's all he likes.
Yep. Agreed. But you heard it here first. Phil Kessel for Spencer Knight. Carl called it. So
I cannot imagine.
Everybody come after Carl. If that trade happened, go after Carl.
Yeah. I will. Yeah. If you believe that happens, feel free to be angry at me. I will be your mortal enemy.
Good stuff. You know, it's funny. Somebody's commented on one of my articles about Detroit's Calvin Pickard, who has played very well at the AHL level. He's got a fair amount of NHL experience, and I'd actually love to see him with the Coyotes, but I just don't think it makes sense. The Red Wings aren't going to pick up Kessel. There's absolutely no reason to trade any assets for Phil Kessel when they're not even going to be in the playoff hunt, more than likely at the end of the day. So I love the idea. Whoever commented on that, I love the idea. I just don't think it's the right fit right now. Haynes, your thoughts on where Phil Kessel ends up by the time the season is all said and done?
You know, that's kind of a question we've been all asking all season. And, you know, we've kind of talked early in the season, first two or three games, Phil Kessel did not look very good on the ice. Led me to believe, many to believe, if he's going to get moved, he's got to really improve production-wise if he wants to get going, because no one's going to take him if he's not producing, and he's lost out there. And he's produced recently in the last few games.
Yeah,
he's looked good. He's gotten better. He's making smarter plays, and he's looking like the Phil Kessel last year that was smart at the puck and not just skating around the ice, just playing Phil Kessel's normal game and all that. So, you know, I think the Lightning are a good fit for him. I think with Kucherov being out, he could be a very solid second line player for him if they need him. You know, I don't really think all the time ahead, maybe Pittsburgh. I know with Crosby and Malkin being out long term, maybe Pittsburgh could be in the fold of bringing back Kessel, adding a little bolstering to their lineup, because the Penguins are likely a playoff team once again this season. But yeah, I would say Tampa, Pittsburgh, somewhere in the East, I feel like he's going to end up going, but we honestly won't know until it happens or when it's going to happen.
Yeah, Pittsburgh crossed my mind as well, for sure. They're pretty banged up. And Carl, I do love, like, all joking aside, I love the thought of Florida. If he ends up in Florida with the Panthers, that is, they're already a darn good team. So that would be pretty impressive. Good stuff. Good stuff. Let's talk about somebody who better be sticking around for a while now. And that would be the one, the only, Jacob Chychrun, who a fan favorite, many, many people's vote for captain when the Coyotes name a new captain, but he's having some issues. He's having some trouble finding the score sheet, and expectations were high considering his output last year. Now, I don't think it's fair for anybody to be putting that type of expectations on somebody who previously was shielded behind someone like an Oliver Ekman-Larsson. He wasn't getting the teams always getting the opposition's best matchups night in and night out, and he's having to adjust to that. But nonetheless, he's been held off the score sheet. So is it time to panic, Carl?
Absolutely not. Exactly like you said, this is his first year being the guy on the defense. He's not getting any easy matchups. He's getting the best. And that's going to take a while for him to adjust. I also think it's like seeing his start, it really makes sense that the team didn't make him captain, just because that would have just been an extra weight on him. And I saw a lot of people like almost demanding it, like in the preseason, and it's just like, no, don't add that pressure. And it's kind of showing that he really didn't need that extra pressure.
That is such a good point, for real. Like, it makes sense. Share the wealth, give out the A, have three A's skating out there, life is good, and keep that pressure collective with the team and not on one individual, when really he's just learning how to be the guy, to be honest. Haynes, your thoughts on Jacob? Should we panic?
No, not at all. You know, Carl said it best, and you said it as well, Pat. He's, you know, this is his first year being the it guy, not only for the team, but the it guy on defense, something that OEL held for so long and Shane Doan held for so many years in Arizona. So it's already a lot for him already now to be the face of the franchise, per se. But I could understand also as well not getting the captaincy. I feel like it'd be an extra weight added onto him on already what's going to be a tough season, But you got to understand also, he's got to also adjust to a new coaching system. I mean, this is not the Tocket system that he's been playing under for, you know, the entirety of his career for the most part and all that, or the entirety of his career. He's having to adjust to a new system. And that's something that, you know, takes time. And, you know, it's so I would not hit the panic button yet. If he doesn't have the grace year this year, I still wouldn't hit the panic button. He's still a young guy, whole new system, whole different team than what he played with last year. Whole different goaltending thing. It's going to be obviously a lot tougher when you're playing on a team that's tanking. So, no, I wouldn't throw any sort of caution to the wind on him. I think he just – it's going to take him some time to find his groove. But once he finds that, I think he'll be fine.
You know, he was laughing at Media Day. It's crazy to think about, but he's literally like the most tenured, one of the most tenured Coyotes on the team. And that's wild. That is how young this team is. That is how rebuilding this team is. And just taking a step outside the captaincy for a minute, I do want to make clear he's had some good opportunities. He's created some good chances. And my God, that rocket of his, like he has, there have been ones that have just whistled wide by this much. I truly believe, just like the two of you said, clearly not time to panic. He's going to get it together. And in the meantime, it's good to be able to get in his feet wet. Cause there's no doubt, even if he doesn't wear the C, he's the leader of this team. They look to him in the locker room. They look to him on the ice. And he's a leader. So I am going to put you guys on the spot really quick, just for the hell of it. So Carl, we'll start with you. Do you think when it's all said and done, will Chychrun be named captain of this team at some point?
At some point, yes. Yep. I think he will. I think the team is invested in him, and that is just, you know, you name that player captain. Like you said, he is a leader on the team. I think he's only going to continue to be a leader on the team.
Yep. Haynes, what about you? You think they'll name Chychrun captain at some point, maybe not even this year?
Yeah, I definitely think I do. I think it's kind of weird to think this, but the way I watch his game and how he is a leader already off the ice, almost kind of to me, he almost embodies a younger version of Shane Doan. You know, came in, made the team at a young age, was drafted in the first round, you know, didn't start off right away as a captain, had to work his way up to the spot to get it. And he's really taken that role as a young guy trying to, you know, fend off these tough questions about what the team's going to be like this year. So I definitely think somewhere down the road, he's going to be named captain.
Yeah. And, you know, to your point, he's always done the right things, said the right things, led by example. And he's always there to answer the questions. If his number gets called and someone wants to ask him a question, regardless of whether it was a good game, bad game, or anything in between, he's a leader on and off the ice. I think he'll be named the captain at some point, but it doesn't happen this year. It may not happen next year. So like you look at a situation, the Red Wings after Zetterberg left, waited 2 years before they named Larkin captain. So, and even then heading into year three, it was questionable. So it's going to be a little while, but agree with you both. Don't put that added pressure on him. He's got enough on his plate right now anyways, and it'll be good to see how he develops throughout the season. So, all right, believe it or not, in record time, we are just about through it, but we do have a quick lightning round question for you guys. No explanation needed, just for fun, out of pure curiosity. Carl, we're going to start with you. When are the Coyotes going to win a game?
Tonight against Lightning.
Oh, yeah. Now that is spicy. I like it.
It's bold. It's bold. I could explain it. I'm not going to.
I love it. You know what? I like it better. Shrouded in mystery. I like it. Haynes, your thoughts?
As much as I'd love to say Washington, I'm going to say Anaheim.
Anaheim. See, Anaheim was my pick as well, but it seemed so far off that I'm going to bump it up one and go Philly at least. So
nice.
Hey, if you think about it though, Pat, what, 2 years ago when we started the season off 0-13, our first win of that season, if I was not wrong, was in overtime from a goal from Mr. Alex Goligoski against the Flyers. So it would not be shocking the Coyotes beat the Flyers again in Philadelphia to get their first win if they are winless heading into Philadelphia.
It's just too bad that he won't be in the lineup, probably.
Maybe we can call him. We can trade for him. It's not too late. Bring him back.
Maybe Gostisbehere exacts a little revenge instead.
Yeah, I'd be fine with that.
I mean, former Coyotes are doing really good against us. We might as well do good against their former team.
Yeah.
Isn't that how it always seems to go, too? Good stuff. Well, Carl, thanks again for being here to do the show. Always a lot of fun to have you on and appreciate you being such a good friend of the show. Haynes, pleasure as always. And you at home, that's it. Thank you for sticking around, for checking us out again. Don't forget, like, comment, subscribe, follow us on Twitter at HowlersTHW. Follow Five for Howling on Twitter at @5Howling. And thanks so much for joining us. We will see you next week, and cheers.